בימים, ואדוני ברך את אברהם בכל. It says, right, that Abraham was zaken, he became old, he was an old man. הקדוש ברוך הוא blessed him with everything, he had everything. So the Chazal say, by the way, it says over here the word bakol, everything. So they say the gematria of bakol is ben, right? Son. So meaning what? That once he got the son now, he had Yitzchak as a son. So now he had everything, because before that he also had all the other things. He had wealth, he had happiness, he had a good wife, he had a good family, he had good everything. He had success in his life. So the only thing he was lacking was a son. Now he also got a son. So now he really had everything. That's what it means, right? Bakol. So now what's left over? The only thing which is left over is to find a wife for his son. You know what I mean? By the way, the Chazal learned from here an important thing. They say that when your children get to the age of marriage, you should try to find for them a suitable mate. You know? It's a mitzvah for the parent to try to look for something like that. Just look around, see over here, look over, ask some questions over here. Here. Try to get something for your children. Why? Because you shouldn't leave them just, you know, unattended like that. Just, they'll find something. God will find for them. Hashem will find for them. Yeah, but also you should make an effort as well to set up something for the children. So this is exactly what Avraham Avinu did over here, right? That once he knew that the time came, so he made a plan over here to get the wife for his son. So he calls his slave Eliezer, who was a big tzaddik. Right? And tells him like this, to Eliezer, he says, "Vayomer Avraham el avdo zaken beto amoshel bechol asher lo, sim na yadecha tachat yerechi." So he tells him like this, right? Put your hand under my thigh. He brings Eliezer, says, put your hand under my thigh. What for? What does the person have to put a hand under your thigh? So in the old days, this was the way people swore. You know, if they made like a neder or whatever, a shu'ah, an oath, so they would put under the thigh like that this was a symbol that the person is swearing about what they're talking about now.
Why under the thigh?
Because the person in that area, you know, the hip area, right, over there, is where his vitality comes from. He makes children from there. You know, everything is from there. So that's like considered to be an important place, you know, and the body, whatever. So that's why I think this is the reason why they used to use that area of the body, the thigh.
Before the circumcision started or before that?
This was after the circumcision, this whole thing. Yeah, sure, this was way after already.
No, I mean that part was considered as vital before circumcision started.
Yeah, because you know you have to procreate, you have to do the mitzvah pruvu. So that existed before, you know.
Existed before Abraham.
Sure. Yes, the mitzvah pruvu was already from the times of Noah.
So,
right?
Time of Noah, yeah. They also considered this part as like more vital part.
Yeah, because you procreate from there, right? You multiply from there. So this is the reason why they put it under the thigh. So he says like this, right? "V'ashbiacha ba'adonai Elohei yeshamayim ve'Elohei ha'aretz asher lo tikach isha livni mibnot kenani asher anuchi yoshev bekirbo." So he says, listen, do me a favor. I have to ask you a very important thing. He says, don't take anybody from my son as a wife from the Canaanites over here in the land of Canaan. Canaan is Israel. So he says, don't take anybody from here. What's the reason why, by the way? What, everybody was bad over there? There wasn't any good people? Mm-hmm. By the way, the truth is that there was some good people over there in Eretz Israel, in Eretz Canaan. How do we know that? Because Abraham himself had friends over there, people who were, you know, aligned with him, who had a pact with him. B'nai B'rit they were, right? People who had a pact with Abraham. So since they had a pact with Abraham, these were tzaddikim, these were good people. So there were some good people in Eretz Israel. So if that's the case, why didn't Abraham agree to take anybody from those families and only want him to go right somewhere else and take from there? What's the reason why? So the Chazal tell us a very important principle, right? That the Canaanim were from Ham, right? And Ham was, and Canaan was cursed. These were cursed people, you understand? What happened was when Noah cursed his son, Ham, in Canaan, he cursed them. So from that time on, these were cursed people. So therefore, once that curse came, you don't want to get involved with a family which is cursed. You know, can you imagine, like, if you were now, you know, trying to marry off your children, You know, and all of a sudden they tell you, oh, go to this guy over here. This guy, you know, was cursed. Some big rabbi cursed him, you know, because he did something. You don't want to get involved with somebody like that. You know, something may happen to him or to his children. So this is why Avraham Avinu didn't want to get involved with the cursed people, where the people of Canaan over there. They were from Ham. So therefore, he wanted to stay away from them. By the way, the Chazal also say something even more amazing, even more strong. That Eliezer himself was also Canaanite, you understand? So Eliezer was also part of that curse. But Eliezer was a tzaddik, he was a slave of Avraham Avinu, he was a big tzaddik, he was a big chacham. And until this time now, he was already a big chacham, big tzaddik. He was like, you know, a great man already, Eliezer. Nevertheless, Eliezer wanted to marry, we wanted that Avraham Avinu should marry his daughter, for his son Yitzchak. But Eliezer was asking for that, hinting at it, alluding to it. But Avraham Avinu was saying, no. Why not? Well, I'm such a bad guy. So why am I the head of your household if I'm such a bad guy? So saying, no, you're not a bad guy. You're a very good guy. You're a tzaddik. But you're cursed. I'm blessed, you understand? HaKadosh Baruch Hu blessed my family. Your family is cursed. So how can we get together, right? It doesn't go together. Cursed family, blessed family. So that therefore he said, listen, you know, I'm sorry to tell you, but when it comes to marriage, you know, when it comes to learning Torah, we can learn Torah all day if you want, no problem. We can study Torah, we can be together in one house. When it comes to bearing children, having a family together, so there we cannot unite together. That's what he told them, you understand? So Eliezer was disappointed, but he had no choice. I mean, you know, he had to accept the rules of his master. So therefore what happened was that now Avram tells him, listen, you have to take my son back to a place that I came from, over there, from my family, from my paternal family, and take a daughter from them, one of the daughters from them, and she's gonna be the wife of my son. That's what it's gonna be, right? Because that family, even though, right, this was the family of Betuel, and Laban Arami was a son of Betuel. These were like wicked people. These were idolaters also. These were like terrible people. So then why did Avraham Avinu want to get together with them, to marry with them, with their family? It's because even though they themselves were wicked people, they themselves were big sinners, but they came from a good line of people, you know, blessed line of people. Shem, you know, was a big tzaddik, the son of Noah, which was a big tzaddik. So therefore, he told them, listen, you know, even though these people are bad people, my family, but they come from a good line, and therefore something good can come out of them. There's good potential from there, you understand? Sometimes what happens is, by the way, is that you have a family of tzaddikim, you know, like, they're all tzaddikim, all the chamim, all this and that. So you say, wow, you know, this is like an amazing family. But then comes out a black sheep, you know, one guy who turns out to be like a drug user, you know, like a, you know, narcoman, you know, like the serious, you know, serious hoodlum, you know, like a low life. So they say, wow, you know, how did this guy come out of this family? You know, like all his family is tzaddikim, all of them are righteous people, and this one is a street punk. It happens, by the way, sometimes. That's what happens, you know. Sometimes even out of a good family comes out an neshama, a soul, which is not so pure, you know. But so he has also a tikkun that he has to do. He has to do rectification in this world.
Why this happens?
I'm sorry?
Why this happens? Like,
why it happens? You know why? Because even though there are some families that are generally good people, but there are some of the neshamot, some of the souls from their family, fell into the klipot. They fell into the impurity, into the tumah. And because of that, those neshamot that fell in, from every family you have people like this, from souls like this. So those people who fell into the klipa, they have to come back out of there, you understand? So they come back to the world, and they come from that family, because that family, that's their root, of their soul, of their neshama, comes from there. So they have to come from there, but they have a tikkun to do. And by the way, it says in the Zohar something amazing, right? That it says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem, He has mercy on people like that. What does that mean? A tzaddik, right? Who's a real big righteous person, a big chacham, but one of his children turns out to be bad. So what HaKadosh Baruch Hu does is, because of the merit of his righteousness, you know, all the good things that he did in this world, so he brings that son back again and again to make sure that he gets his tikkun. Why? Because he doesn't want that the son of such a big tzaddik should be left without a tikkun, without a rectification. So he brings them back again and again until everything is fixed up. Because he wants to do, just like this person, you know, who was a tzaddik, did chesed, did kindness for the world by spreading Torah and spreading the word of God. Also, Kadosh Baruch Hu says, since you did that for me, I also am going to do you a favor and make sure that your children all turn out to be righteous. That's what he tells them. So he brings them back again and again. So this is why they have to come back, you know, and again, they have to fix up what whatever problems they had. So, Rabotai, interesting thing, right? That now Eliezer is disappointed. Ki el atzi ve'el.
Eliezer was considered a Jew or not?
Eliezer, well, you know, in those days what happened was that Avraham Avinu was converting people. He was converting. His wife was converting the ladies, and he was converting the men. That's the way it was. So, for sure, Eliezer must have been converted. Because, you know, I mean, he was like the main Talmid of Avraham Avinu. So therefore, he must have been converted, but still, because he came from bad roots, he still didn't want to deal with him. You know, didn't want to deal with that. But it's, in terms of conversion is a different story, right? You can convert somebody who comes from a cursed family. You know, that's not a problem. But to marry into that family, that's a very different issue. You know, you have to think about what the connotations are from that, right? What the results can be. That's a different issue. Two different things. So he says. כי אל ארצי ואל מולתי תלך ולקחת אישה דבני ליצחק ויאמר אליו העבד אולי לא טובה האישה ללכת אחריי אל הארץ הזאת השב אשיב את בנך את הארץ אשר יצאת משם. So now Eliezer, being the faithful man that he is, right, honest man, tells Avraham Avinu like this. Listen, you know, you're sending me now to find a wife for your son. Okay, very good, I'm going. But let me ask you a question. If that lady doesn't want to come back here, you know, to Eretz Israel, She wants to get married, but she wants to live somewhere else. She wants to live over there where she was born. You know, she doesn't want to come back here. So then he asks him like this. He says, what should I do now? Should I also take her in a case like that? What does that mean? That will you allow your son Yitzhak to go and live in Chutz La'aretz, in Iraq or in Syria, you know, place like that, you know, with ISIS over there, you know, whatever, you know. Will you let him with ISIS over there? I'm joking, but what I'm trying to tell you is that he asked him this question, you know, will you let him go or not? So he answered, Avraham Avinu answers him, no way. Right? He answers him like that, right? Flat out, no. So he says, no way. You're never going to take my son out of Eretz Israel, right? He's always going to be here. He's never going to leave. That's what he tells him. And by the way, this now brings up a good question. What's the question? Why was he so adamant about this, that his son shouldn't leave Eretz Israel? I mean, the truth is, there is a halakha that says that a person who lives in Eretz Israel, he's not allowed to leave. Why is that? Because it's a holy land, you know, you're leaving the holy land, you're going somewhere else to live. You're going to live in Rigo Park? You think Rigo Park is going to give you the same holiness that Jerusalem is going to give you? Or even, you know, Tel Aviv, which is not such a holy place, right? Comparatively speaking. But still, it's much more holy than Rigo Park. You understand? It's not the same thing. Even though there's a lot of Jews over here in Rigo Park, there's a main street here, there, whatever it is, you know, five towns, wherever you want to go. There's a lot of Jews there, Williamsburg, you know, there's Rigo, the Borough Park, Flatbush. There's a lot of Jews over there, that's true. But there's nothing like the Holy Land, you know. Why is that, by the way? What's the reason for that? The reason is because over there's a different system, a spiritual system over there that works over there. What does that mean? Over there in the Holy Land, God, you know, directly supervises over everything that goes on there in a direct manner without any intermediary. Over here in Chutz La'aretz, right, in Rigo Park, where we live, it's not the same thing. What's the difference? The difference is that over here there's an angel, like a tsar, you know, a prince that's directed by God to run this place, this area, this country. And that prince, that heavenly prince, runs this place. So therefore what? There's some kind of intermediary between God and us. And we have to accept his rule over us. You understand? It's like, you know, he rules over this land. So you can't circumvent that. You can't go around it. There's no way to go around. So what do I care about all this? What difference does it make to me? I'm still the same guy I was yesterday. So what difference does it make? So the answer is over time. The difference that it makes is like this. That because it's run by an intermediary, this intermediary is interested in the furtherance of his own nation. You understand? He's not interested in furthering your needs. He wants to further his own nation's needs. So meaning what? That every nation, right? America has their own also intermediary, just like we're here. Every other country, the same thing. So that intermediary he wants to make sure that his country is doing good, right? He doesn't care about you. So what does that mean? He'll do what has to be done to you too. He'll agree to that too. But he wants for that some tax, you understand? You're not going to do it for free. He wants to pay, you know, you've got to pay the income tax over there. You've got to pay the head tax, whatever it is, all these things, private, real estate tax, property tax. You've got to pay also to this heavenly prince. You also have to pay tax. What does that mean? The mitzvot and the prayers that the Jews do over here in Rigo Park, in Chutz La'aretz, in America, wherever it is, in California, Los Angeles, that heavenly prince takes a cut out of that. You understand? He takes a percentage. Just like, you know, when you have a government, right? The government also takes like a part of your money, right? It takes taxes. So this government, this heavenly government that operates this country, also wants, you know, a share of your mitzvot, a share of your Torah, a share of your prayers, of all these things. He wants to take that. So when he takes that, what's a practical thing? The thing is that we're losing also something from there, you understand? Something is being lost. And therefore, it's like, that's why the Chazal say, right, that a person who lives in Chutz La'aretz, outside of Israel, he's considered to be like an idol worshiper, you know, like idolater. He's like worshiping idols. What does that mean? That since that heavenly prince that runs that country, you know, in a different place, is operating that place, and he is in charge of an idolatrous nation, so it's like you're serving that prince, which is like some kind of idol. You're going through an intermediary to get to God. You're not going to God directly. So it's like considered to be like you're worshiping idols. But notwithstanding all this, nevertheless, the halacha is, Rabotai, the halacha, the Jewish law says that what? That there are certain reasons a person is allowed to leave Eretz Israel. There are certain reasons, right? The Rambam brings down three reasons for this. One of them is to study Torah, right? Let's say your rabbi is in you know, lives in Brooklyn, whatever. So the only way you can study with him is to move to Brooklyn. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to study with him. Okay, you can do something maybe over the phone, over the internet, something, whatever. But that's not really a real connection. That's not really, you know, that's something very light, it's not significant, right? So therefore, if a person really wants to learn from his rabbi, he has to be there, right, in his room, right, by his side. And that's the way you have to learn from a rabbi. You cannot learn from a rabbi long distance like that. That's not really the best way to do it. So if a person wants to learn Torah with a rabbi in Brooklyn, he's allowed to move there, even though he lived in Kfar Saba, right? Whatever, he was living over there. Now he's allowed to go to live to Brooklyn over there. There's also two other reasons brought down the Rambam. One is to get married, right? What does that mean, to get married? That let's say you can't find over there, right, a good shidduch, can't find a good mate over there in Israel. So now you got to look elsewhere. What can you do? You know, maybe whatever. There's not enough Georgians over there where you live. You know, whatever. So you know, you want to go and look over there in Forest Hills, Rigo Park. Maybe you'll find something over there. So a person is allowed to go, leave Eretz Israel, to go to find a wife in Rigo Park. That's the way it is.
What about this idea? I actually saw it in a movie once, an interesting movie, where you don't have to leave your dwelling in order for your soulmate to come to you. Hashem will bring him or her to you.
Yeah, it's a very good question. Very good question.
Where you are, according to the Torah.
Very good question. Excellent question. Yeah. So the answer is, David, that there's two methods that work with this. There's two types of things. Sometimes it's the girl who has to go to the guy, where the guy lives. Welcome. You understand? Sometimes it's the girl that has to go to the guy, and sometimes it's the guy that has to go to the girl. You understand? So depending on the situation, somebody's got to move. You understand? You can't both stay in one place.
Yes.
You know, the world is not going to shrink and, you know, shrivel. You know, going to come together like that.
Yes.
Somebody's got to go.
So
you know?
If I refuse to leave my dwelling,
yeah,
and I do want to get married,
God bless you.
It's not pertaining to me personally. It's just a general question.
Yes.
If I refuse to leave, or move, or look, will God send my mate to me?
It's a very good question he's asking.
It was Mazon, yes.
Very good question. So, you know, this question, by the way, was asked already by the wisest of men, King Solomon, right? Shlomo Melech. He already had this question. He wanted to know how this thing works, you understand? How far does it go, you know? Like, how extreme can you be with this thing, you know? So he did experiments. What do you do? It says in the Midrash, right, that what he did was he had a daughter, you understand? So he had a daughter.
Good.
Yeah, good, nice one.
Very good.
So the daughter, what he did was he flew her over to a deserted island, you know? Gilligan's Island, you know? We put him over there. So he puts her over there with some servants, you know, people to help her to sell, you know, to help her to live. Yeah, his daughter, yeah. His own daughter, yeah. So he says, you know what? I want to see now if Hashem will take that, you know, that person who's supposed to be my daughter's husband and take her to the island, you know, let's see if he's going to wind up there or not.
I heard that a little different. Let me Shlomo Melech was told that his daughter would marry a peasant. A peasant. So he was thinking at 18 years old, he would marry a peasant.
Mm-hmm.
At 18 years old, he said, you know what? My son-in-law to be a peasant, so he flew her bullet on the Gilligan's Island.
To avoid this
matchmaking.
Yeah. Right. By the way, what you're saying doesn't contradict what I'm saying. Just a different facet
of
the... Right,
version,
different facet.
It's
the same thing, same idea.
Same
the point
thing.
Is, Rabotai, what
well,
happened
actually,
was... Yeah.
I apologize, Robert. It's interesting. It doesn't contradict it, but it already changes why he sent her there, because he didn't want to wind up with a peasant son-in-law.
Right, but
so
he also wanted to see if it's going to work. You understand? He wanted to see that.
Yeah.
It was an experiment. Yeah. Right, but he wanted to see if it's going to work or not.
Work.
You know, he wanted to see that. Right, that was
are
that
we,
was
are
that
we
was.
Allowed to avoid our fate?
That's also a good question. That's also first we have to answer this question, right? These are amazing questions, by the way. What you guys are asking, amazing questions.
Well, no matter what I tried in 52 years, I haven't been able to avoid anything.
Well, you're just like everybody else. You're just like everybody else, David. So, Rabotai, what it says like this, right, that Kadosh Baruch Hu, one day, this guy who was supposed to marry her, what happened was that he was walking somewhere in the street, you know, and he fell asleep, you know, like something, you know, sleep came over him, whatever, and came a big, like, stork, big bird, you know,
mm-hmm.
and took him, picked him up, and flew him over to the island, you understand? And he, right, so he, you know, he had to, they met, made up, and they got married, that's what happened. So,
really?
So we see from there, right, that Kadosh Baruch Hu, well, you know, if a person is destined to marry somebody, the person is destined to marry somebody, he will marry that person, whatever, no matter what. You understand? Unless he refuses, he can also refuse. He does have the choice to refuse. You know, there are some people, by the way, who do refuse. What does that mean? Some people are very picky, you know? They're like too picky. So what happens is that because of that, they lose their match sometimes in life.
Wow.
Yeah. Because, you know, like he's like looking at the girl, you know, on the nose and the ears and this and this. Too much here, too much there. The eyes and this. And the eyelashes and this. And she's a very good girl, you know, let's say, right? He doesn't know.
He doesn't know.
But because he was too picky, you understand? It could be that he missed his destined... Right. Yeah, too picky.
It
happened
to people all the time.
Yeah. By the way, I don't mean to tell you.
And you don't know that you're missing out on your match.
Right, you don't know. Yeah, you don't know. You really have no way to know. But I don't mean to tell you, by the way, don't get me wrong, right, that you shouldn't look to be attracted to a girl. You should be attracted. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. There has to be attraction. Yeah. There has to be attraction, but you cannot be, you know, too crazy about these things. You know what I mean? Too particular, too meticulous. Every little thing, you know.
Melania Trump.
Looking with a magnifying glass. You know, microscope, you know, too much. After all, it's a human being, you know. What do you expect her to be? What, you know, a doll? You want a Barbie doll? What are you looking for? You understand? You have to have, you have to understand. This is, so, Rabotai, getting back to what we're saying. So the truth is, right, that when it comes to Shiduchim, it does work very, very, very strong. So if that's the case, that a person is allowed to leave Eretz Israel to find a Shiduch, he is allowed to do that. By the way, don't get me wrong though. When I tell you that he's allowed to leave Eretz Yisrael for that, what that means is once he finishes the mitzvah, he has to go back. You know, meaning what? Once you found a girl, right? You went to some family, right? The Israel family, right? You found a nice girl over there, and now you're gonna ask, right, Jimmy, right? You're gonna ask him, Jimmy. You know what? Your daughter is beautiful, and I want to marry her and everything, but you know, I live in Israel, so I'm gonna take her back there. You know. What can I do? So if Jimmy will allow you, you understand? If Jimmy will allow you, so you're gonna take her back. If he's not gonna allow you, so you're gonna have to, you know, come up with some kind of a solution. You've got to ask the girl, right? You know, who do you want to listen to? You want to listen to your father or you want to listen to me? Who do you think is more right? And this is exactly what happened over here, as we're gonna see.
And usually it creates all kinds of complications.
Yeah, right. So anyway, Rabotai, so if that's the case, that if a person is allowed to leave Eretz Israel to find a shiduch. So then why didn't Avraham Avinu allow his son to leave for that reason? You know, he said to Eliezer, no, be careful, you know, don't take my son out of here. What's the story over there? So we already discussed this a few weeks ago. I think you guys weren't here, but he was here. There was a reason Yitzhak Avinu was different than all the others. Because we really find, right, that he was the only one out of the forefathers that never left Eretz Israel. Abraham left. He had to go to Egypt. He had to go. He had to go around also in other places. Yaakov also left. He went to the house of Laban. He also left. The house of Laban was in Syria somewhere, whatever. So that's the case. Why wasn't Yitzhak allowed to go? So the answer was, Rabbi, that Yitzhak Avinu had something special. What was that? He was brought up as a korban, as a sacrifice. You understand? During the binding of Yitzhak, he was brought up as an olat tamima. He was once a person is brought up as a sacrifice on the Mizbeach. By the way, he was the only one who was brought up like that. So you know, this is not something that happens every day. This is something once in history that happens like this, something like that. So he was brought up as a sacrifice. So once a person is sanctified as a korban, as a sacrifice, so then Bemet, he's not allowed to leave Eretz Israel for any reason, right? There's no exceptions. This is the reason why Avraham Avinu said no. When it comes to my son. No way, there's no chance. He's not allowed to leave for any reason. You know, that's what he told. And by the way, the Chazal say, right, that he alluded in his words to something. He said, my son won't leave, but you know who's going to leave? My grandson, Yaakov, he will leave, right? He knew that, right? He knew that Yaakov's grandson was destined to leave, but when it comes to his son, Yitzhak, he was not supposed to leave, right? That's the way it is. Okay, but let's continue. Amen. So, this is the reason why he was so adamant about it. So, Adonai Elohei Shamayim, Asher Lekachani Mibet Avi, Umeretz Mulati, Vasher Diber Li, Vasher Nishba Li, Lemo Lezaracha Eten Et Haaretz Hazot, Hu Yishlach Malacho Lefanecha, Velakachta Isha Livni Misham. So he says, you know what, Hashem is going to help you, I bless you. He blessed him, right? Hashem is going to help you to find us a mate for my son. Don't worry, everything will be okay, don't worry about it. By the way, he also had prior knowledge to this whole thing. As we already discussed a couple weeks ago, what happened was that he was notified already. That the mate of Yitzchak was already born, right? They knew that the mate of Yitzchak was Rivka. She was born in the family also from the same family as Avraham Avinu. So they already pretty much knew that he was supposed to marry her. But it's just a matter of now, as we said, right, to get together and actually, you know, to perform the act. Because as we said, right, a person can refuse. You know, I mean, she could have refused him if she wanted. You know, nobody can force her to. You cannot force somebody to marry you. So she also could have refused. So practically speaking, it had to be, you know, it had to be activated, this whole thing. It had to be performed. So Eliezer, okay, is willing to go, no problem, right? He'll do anything as his master tells him to do. So he went. Ve'im lo toveh ha'isha lalechet acharecha, v'nikita mishpirati zot, rak et b'ni lo tashev shama. So he says, you know what? Avraham tells him, he says, just in case the girl won't want to come back to Eretz Israel, right, this girl. So then you'll be free from my oath. Meaning what? I just made you take an oath now. That what? That you must do this job that I told you to do. You must perform it. But he told him like this. Once you perform the job, you try to do it. Meaning what? You went over there. And she refused you. So then the oath is now, you're absolved from the oath. You have no more, you know, obligation.
Why did he force him to take an oath?
Because this was something very crucial to him. You understand?
Understand. This is the master. This is the servant. The master tells the servant what to do.
Right.
And the servant does it.
You know, the reason is because before you came just now, we discussed the issue that Eliezer here had alternative motives here.
Yeah, right.
You understand? Exactly. So that's, he had to give him strength over here to overcome that desire, you know? He had to make sure that this, you know, his desire, what was in his heart shouldn't overcome what's in his mind, what the logic says to him. So this is the reason why he had to strengthen him over here, you know, very strong to make sure that he does the right thing. Cause he also wanted to get it. He wanted to be in the family. He wanted to get in the family. That was his whole intention over here. That was the whole idea. Okay, so let's go on over time. וישם העבד את ידו תחת ירך אברהם אדוניו וישבע לו הדבר הזה ויקח העבד עשרה גמלים גמלי אדוניו וילך וכל טוב אדוניו בידו ויקום וילך אל ארם נהריים אל עיר נחור, right? This is, by the way, now this is a lesson in matchmaking over here, right? If you guys want to know how do you do matchmaking, right, for your children, you know, you want to marry them off, so this is the way to do it, right? What do you do over here? The classic matchmaking techniques. Right, tells him Eliezer, listen, not only you're going to go by yourself, what do you think I'm going to send you empty-handed? I'm going to send you beautiful jewelry, you know, beautiful things, beautiful prizes, beautiful gifts. You're going to go there laden, you know, with the best beautiful things. Why? Because when you come there, you have to make an impression.
So this is allowed.
Yeah, it's a mitzvah to do that, right? It's not only it's allowed, it's a mitzvah, right? Because you want to make sure that the shidduch goes well, you know, you want to chachos this, you know? You want to get it together. So this is the way to do it. The person has to be smart. Why? Because you have to make that bait, you know, that's just like when you want a fish, you know, you got to put the bait in there, mm-hmm. that worm. This is the worm for the shidduch. You understand? This is the same thing. It's the same idea. Practical, you know, practical matchmaking techniques.
So Georgian.
Not only that, right? Yeah, Jewish, you know, Jewish, because even the Jewish, you know, in general, right? So not only that, by the way, he also sent him something even stronger than that. Because after all, you know, I mean, how much can you send with one person, you know? I mean, you can't send him like a truckload. He was basically going on with a donkey, you know, with a camel, whatever it was. So he can't trust, he can't send everything. So what he did was he gave him a contract, you know, like a shtar, you know, document. It says in the document, everything that Avraham owns will be inherited by Yitzhak. You know, so this way he knows, right? He's going to get 100% inheritance from all his wealth, right? So we're talking about millions of dollars here, right? We're talking about big time, right? Yeah. So, once the family sees that, they're going to say, ooh, you should go with this guy, right? You're going to live good. Yeah. Right? You're going to have a good life. So that's the way, right? That was a matchmaking technique over here, right? That was a smart way to do it. So then, Rabotai, let's go on. So he came now, Eliezer comes to that area, he arrives. וכך העבד עשה גמלים בגמלי אדוניו והלך בכל טוב אדוניו בידו ויקום מלך אל המערה מנהריים אל עיר נחור. Right, by the way, the Chazal say over here from this pasuk that really he got there the same day that he left, you know, in other words, what happened was that HaKadosh Baruch Hu made a miracle for him and the earth, you know, like
shrunk,
right, and shriveled, and he got there the same day that he left, right away he got there, you know. So this is the level they were on, by the way. You should know that even the slave of Avraham Avinu was on such a high level like that, to do such a thing like this, which is something amazing, right? It's against nature, totally miracle. So you see that what level these people were on, right? The supernatural things were happening to them day, night and day, when the angels coming and this and all kinds of things, as we already saw, right, in the other narratives that we talked about. So now he comes, right, Eliezer, and he camps over there. Where does he find? Where does he camp? He camps by some well over there, right? There's a well. People are taking water from there. They're drawing water. So they say, by the way, that this is also not an accident. Why? Because they say, right, that the well is a conducive place for a shidduch for some reason, you know, because it springs out like there's a spring over there. There's a water spring, and it gushes out, right? Gives you water. So that's like considered to be like a symbol of blessing, you know. So they say, right, that since it's a symbol of blessing, you want to have be fruitful and multiply with your mate. So that's the place to go, right? If you want to get a good shidduch, to go to the well. By the way, today we don't have wells, so you know we have to find a different solution. Okay. We're not really going to wells. Right? So that's the way it is over time. So this is the reason why he camped over there, Tafka, you know, by the well. ויברך המלים, ויאמר אדוני אלוהי אדוני אברהם, הקרא נא לפני היום ועשה חסד עם אדוני אברהם. So now, right, something interesting happens over here, which Eliezer is criticized for, by the way, by the Chazal, you know, what he did over here. He said now prayer to God. Once he gets there, he starts to pray to God. He says, listen, you know, do me a favor, Lord, you know, just make this thing, you know, successful. Make it easy for me so I can just find this girl. I don't know what I'm doing, you know, I don't know what to look for. So make my life easier for me. Just, you know, bring me the girl over here. That make it happen that the girl should come right now to this place. And this way we can close the deal, you know, and go back home. I don't want to stay here forever. You know, this is not a long-term project.
So
now he says a very interesting prayer right over here, Eliezer. He says, you know what? Do me a favor. God, you know, do me a favor. I want you now to send me this girl over here to the well. But I don't know how to tell which one it's going to be. You know, maybe there's 10 girls going to come here. So I don't know which one it is. I have no way to know that. So he says, you know, but let's give me a sign. You know what the sign will be? If a girl will come and I will ask her, you know, to give me some water to drink. Why? Because she's coming over there to give drink to the animals, to the, you know, to the livestock that they have. That's what they were coming there for. They're not coming there just to, you know, for fun, right? This was not a hangout area over there. This was a place where they gave water to their animals, you know, to the people also they needed for the house, for them to take home. So what happened was, he says, you know what, the girl, I'm going to ask the girl, I'm thirsty, you know, can you give me some water? Like, from the water that you're drawing, also give me like one cup, one glass for me also. Do me a favor. I'm very thirsty. So he says, if she will come and say, listen, I'll give you no problem, you know, very happily give you. So he says, that should be the girl, you know, but that should be the sign that that she's the right one for Yitzhak. So the Chazal say this was a bad thing to do, by the way. This was a bad prayer. A person has to also know how to pray, you know. This is not the way to pray. By the way, this is the reason why today we have a set prayer that we pray in the Amidah, you know. This is something where the Anshei Knesset HaGdolah, they made everything automatically, wrote everything down. So they knew what we had to pray for. So because of that, when we pray that set prayer every day, that's like it covers all the bases. You know, so we're always going to pray for the right thing, you know, whatever. No matter what, if you can't go wrong with that one. You understand? It's like the best recipe that you can have for prayers. So, but in those days, they didn't have a set prayer like that. So he came up with something which was not so good. So what was the story? The story was, he says, as we said, right, that as we just mentioned. So the Chazal criticized that. They say, you know what was the problem? The problem was that, listen, you're saying that the one who comes and gives you water to drink, that should be the one, right? But maybe it's going to be somebody who's like a crippled girl, you know, amputated leg. Or somebody who's a slave girl, you know, some... That also should be Yitzhak's wife. What do you want? You want a crippled girl for Yitzhak? That's what you want? Maybe she's going to be the one who's going to give you. So he didn't ask properly this request that he made to Hashem.
But you have a choice to refuse. If a cripple comes and gives him water, say no.
Right, but the thing is that he's saying that, you know, I'm going to accept that as a sign, like unconditional sign, you understand? In other words, if that happens, I'm taking it. Whatever it is, I'm taking it. He's committing to that. Which was a mistake, you know. You shouldn't commit to something that you're going to regret. That's the whole thing, right? Good question, by the way, what you're asking. It's a very good question, very insightful question. I had the same question also, what you're asking. So now the thing is that even though they say it, right, that he didn't ask properly over here, Rakadosh Baruch Hu anyway gave him success, you know. He found favor in the eyes of God, this man, right? He was a tzaddik. He was a righteous man. So even though he didn't ask properly, Hashem said, you know what, I'll let you off the hook. Don't worry about it, you know. We're gonna set you up, right? For sure he understood, right? But it wasn't proper, you know, whatever. Hashem always understands, right? He always understands everything. But they say, by the way, that there was also another case where somebody asked similarly, like this kind of a lottery kind of a thing, you know? Lottery kind of a request. If this one will come, you know, whatever will come. What do you mean whatever will come? How do you know it's gonna come? So what's the story? They say, right, that there was in the times of the first Beit HaMikdash, even before the first Beit HaMikdash was built, there was one leader, right? His name was Iftach. Iftach was one of the judges, right? The Shoftim. So they say that Iftach was going to war against the enemies, and he had to strengthen himself. You know, he was a mighty man, but he had to strengthen himself. So what he did was he made an oath to Hashem. You know, before he left, he said, you know what? If I win this war, if HaKadosh Baruch Hu will help me to win the war, so when I come back, the first thing that comes out of my home, I will bring it up as a sacrifice, you know. Right from that way. So this was also, they say the Chazal, it was the same mistake that Eliezer made. Same kind of mistake. What's the mistake? What about if a dog comes out? You're going to put a dog for a sacrifice? You don't bring dogs for a sacrifice, right? Dog is a tummy animal, it's impure. So you don't bring a dog as a sacrifice. So what are you going to do? You shouldn't say something like that. You're making a lottery out of it. If this will come out, if that will come out, what are you gambling? What's the gambling? You can't gamble with these kinds of things. So they say the Chazal, right? That also Iftach asked in an improper manner like that. But the difference is, right, that Eliezer was answered properly. But Iftach was not answered properly. Meaning what? He got messed up with this. Why is that, by the way? Why would Eliezer have such good luck? You know, they let him off the hook. When it comes to Iftach, He fell right on his face, right? Flat on his face. What's the difference? They say, right, Iftach, the reason is because he wasn't such a big tzaddik like Eliezer. He was Amaretz. He wasn't so learned in Torah. He was, regular, simple Jew, you know, one of these guys who reads Tehillim, you know, all day, you know, one of these guys. He wasn't a big chacham. He wasn't a big rabbi.
He wasn't?
Huh?
He was the king.
He was a president, that kind of thing. You know, like but in those days there was no king, right? They say
there was, right, exactly.
He was like a you know, like a prime minister kind of thing, right? Something like that. You know, leader of the country, right? A king is considered to be on a higher level, right? It's a higher position. King, it has more responsibility, more privileges, and so on.
So he was at the highest position at that time.
At that time, exactly. Right.
So he
politically, right? Not religiously, right? Politically,
he was
politically. Right. Yeah, something like that, right? Okay.
Planes, could call it whatever. Right. He was the head.
So, right, exactly. So just like, you know, nowadays, by the way, we have also these prime ministers, you know, who are, you know, they're really good Jews, God bless them, you know, but they don't know anything about Judaism. They don't know, you know, so they're ignorant. They're Amharats.
Would you consider
them? They're good. They want good for the people, you know, they really do, but they don't know what's the good. That's the problem. You know, sometimes they don't know what's good. You know, because they haven't learned Torah, they haven't, you know, they don't have education in Torah. They don't have so because of that, so we're like in the same situation as they were at that time. You understand? Pretty much, we have like these ignorant leaders who are coming up, you know, political leaders who don't know Torah, and because of that, sometimes they make big mistakes. You know, and we see what it leads to. We don't have to get into it, right? So what happened was that Yiftach, when he came back from the war, he won the war, right? But then who comes out of the door, right? When he comes, his daughter came out, right? Mm-hmm. So now what is he going to do? Sacrifice your daughter? This was a very foolish thing what he did, you understand? So in the end, by the way, they had a big problem with this. You know, whether they should sacrifice her really or not. Can you sacrifice your daughter? Can you sacrifice a human being? You know, there are all kinds of things. In the end, by the way, they didn't sacrifice her. According to the Chazal, what they did was, there are different opinions, by the way, about this, Jimmy. You may be thinking about, right. There's different opinions, but the most acceptable opinion, you know, according to the, you know, simple, you know, logic, is that what they did was they didn't bring her up as a sacrifice, because that you cannot do. You cannot kill a person, a human being. You cannot do that. Yeah. So what they did was they put her in a isolated area somewhere in Israel, and they didn't allow her to get married, so she had to stay like a you know, little a nun, you know, left, you understand, with no husband, no husband, no nothing. She had to stay over there like isolated, and it was as if like they, you know, they she, you know, they killed her, you know, whatever, you know. That, yeah, her whole life she was like that. Yeah. And this is what happened. And by the way, this was a big mistake what they did also. Mm-hmm. You understand? This was a very stupid, foolish thing what they did. And why did they do such a foolish thing? Meaning what? This was not the proper solution for that. The solution should have been, they should have gone to a big rabbi, and the rabbi would have annulled the oath. That would have been, you understand? But they were so foolish, they were so, you know, they were so full of, their head was full, so full of some thick fixing, their head, thick-headed. So they didn't even want to go to the rabbi and ask, you know, Pinchas was a big rabbi. Right, exactly. They didn't want to go to Pinchas. Pinchas was a big rabbi at that time. So he could have come and annulled it, but they didn't call him up.
It's not that the king, Yiftach, said, I'm the king, I'm the leader, the rabbi has to come to me.
Oh, there you go.
Right? And the rabbi said, I'm the religious leader, let the king come to me.
Exactly.
He needs me more than I need.
Yeah, so they both messed up, right?
So they both messed up.
Yeah, absolutely, Jim.
Honor and self-respect. And,
exactly. You know? Ego problems. Ego problems. Yeah, exactly, exactly. You learn from there, by the way. Not
the poor girl sucked.
She had to suffer. By the way, they say you should know that this was also not for nothing, that this girl has to suffer like that. This was also a divine plan. What does that mean? What divine plan is that? A girl should sit there like a nun all her life, not get married, not have children, be alone in somewhere, isolated somewhere, in the desert. So what's the story? So they say the story is, it was a very good thing what happened to her. Why? Because she was a Gilgul, she was reincarnated from somebody who did a sin regarding that. You understand? What was the sin? That she was the Gilgul, during her reincarnation, of the wife of Ham. So right, remember that we talked about this. That right, exactly. In the ark, they say right that Ham was the only one the only human being over there that sinned. Meaning what? That at that time, Kadosh Baruch Hu commanded them when they were in the ark during the flood, they should have no relations with their wives, right? Separate from their wives, abstinence. Right? That's what they had to do. So Ham, you know, was like had a weak nature regarding that. Right? He was into it. So he jumped in right with his wife and he couldn't resist. And because of that, right, he turned black. That's the reason why we talked about that before. But the point is, Abutai, is that now they say that because she sinned, you know, regarding having relations with her husband in the ark, so HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought her back as this girl in order to atone for that sin. That what? That she should never have relations with a man during her life, in order to atone for that sin that she did during the time of the ark. So everything has a purpose in this world. You know, nothing happens for no reason. Everything has a purpose, even though it doesn't make sense. You know, if you think about, oh my God, you know, like, how can you do something like that to a girl like that? It doesn't make any sense. Right? But everything makes sense. So anyway, Rabbi, getting back to what we're saying, Eliezer was answered in a good way. You know, because he was a tzaddik, even though he asked the wrong way. So what happened was that HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought out Rivka, you know, to the water her, the animals over there and everything. So Eliezer sees her and says, ooh, this is a good girl. How do you know, by the way, she was a good girl? What was the sign? They say, right, that the Chazal, they say that when she came back, when she came close to the well, the water came up, right, to greet her, you know? So they said, oh, this must be a good girl. If the water comes up like that to greet her, it must be that this is the one, right, that she's destined for my master's son. So he tells her, can you give me some water, you know, to drink? I'm thirsty, you know, I just came from the road. Very thirsty guy. So she says, not only I'm going to give you, no problem, right? I'm going to give you also to your animals, right? He had camels over there that need a lot of water. Camels drink like, you know, 2 tons of water each one. You understand? So he says, I'm going to give you water for you, your animals, right? Probably there was a few camels over there. So we're talking about, like, you know, let's say an hour's worth of work here. We're not talking about something small. With one bucket, you know, a little bucket, you know. another one. when he saw that, he was like totally amazed with this girl, you know. Meaning what? That she's like above and beyond anything that, you know, he ever expected. My God, you know, like, who does this thing like that? You know, not only gives you, but you're also to your camels a drink. So by the way, what do we care about this? Why dafka did he want this sign, to know that this was the right one for Yitzchak? Why was he to give me water to drink? What's the purpose of that? So they say the Chazal, there's a purpose also for that. The purpose is that, you know, when a person is a Yitzchak Avinu, you know, was a big chacham, he was a big tzaddik, and he was doing the service of God, you know, the service of the Lord, busy all day with Torah and mitzvot, and, you know, teaching Torah to the public and all these things. So a person like that doesn't have time to take care of the whole household chores. You understand? He cannot do housework and go into the kitchen, you know, start cooking and cleaning the floor and doing laundry. He doesn't have time for that. So he needs a girl. You understand? Who's really, really a chesed girl. Somebody who does kindness, you know, also, she has to be like above and beyond what most people, most women are. Like, because most women, you know, what are they going to tell you when you get married? She's going to tell you, listen, can you help me out with this a little bit, this, that, you know, feed the children for me, take them to walk, you know, in the street, take them out, you know, to play ball. So, but Yitzhak Avinu doesn't have time for these things. You know, doesn't have time for these little chores, you know, these little things, you know, to go to the zoo, you know, take the kids to the zoo today. Yitzhak Avinu is going to go to the zoo. You know, take the children to the zoo. He doesn't have time for that. So, you know, a person like that needs like 24 hours, you know, of service. Mm-hmm. In a sense, so she needs a woman who's like above and beyond. And this is the reason why he was looking for a girl like this. You understand? This is, by the way, the same thing today also applies. That these guys who commit themselves to sit and learn Torah all day. All, you know, the become a big chacham, become a chacham. So they need a wife who's very supportive, you know, people like that. You know, she can sacrifice her, you know, her, and not tell the husband, you know, do this and do that and go here and go there and go to the IRS and go to this, go to the bank and this and that. Who has time for that? You know, this guy's sitting learning Torah all day. You know, he's a Tamil chacham. He doesn't have time for these things. So she has to do most of the chores like this, you understand? And this is the way Torah family functions like that. So that's why she needed he needed a girl like that. By the way, it's also an interesting thing that if you ever go to as a guest, you know, to somebody's house, who usually helps you out more, the wife or the husband? Mm-hmm. Who's the one who gives you the food, gives you the service? It's the wife, right? I mean, the husband doesn't do anything. All he does is sit there and talk, you know, blah, 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 talks, you know, and holds up the glass of wine, you know, satrazelo, you know, blah, blah, blah. Who's doing the real work? The women are doing the work. He's sitting there, right, and talking with you. He's not doing nothing. Also, when you go as a guest, by the way, you know, to somebody's house, by the way, like, let's say you go to Israel, right? So you don't want to go to a hotel, you know, you want to save some money, whatever. So you want to go as a guest to somebody's house, you know, some Georgian guy over there, somebody who lives in Lud, you know, whatever. And, So you go over there as some Georgian, and so when you sleep there, right, you're going to be there for a week, let's say, or 2 weeks. Who's going to serve you every day, morning, in the morning, the breakfast? The wife is going to do it, right? He's going to serve you? He's not going to do nothing for you. He's just going to sit there and talk to you, you know, have a nice conversation. The wife is going to do everything. So we see from there, by the way, that the real chesed of the family is always, you know, the wife does it. But that's a little bit of a problem. You know why? Because the Chazal, the Mekubalim, they say, the Zohar says, that really, right, the midah of chesed, the quality of chesed, kindness, is really the man. And the woman is the quality of din, you know, it's judgment. Just the opposite, right? Women are the quality of judgment. And the men are the quality of chesed. So if that's the case, why is it always the woman who jumps on you, you know, and helps you out with everything when you go to somebody as a guest? What's the reason for that? So the Zohar says something amazing, right? It says that even though the quality of women is din, right, it's judgment, and the woman is chesed, but that's only before she gets married. What happens is, right, that she when she's born a girl, her quality is din, judgment, right? And that's, by the way, the reason why this person has to be careful not to mistreat his wife. Because since the quality of judgment is in the woman, you understand? So she can punish you. What does that mean? That she has a kfeda on you. She has the right, she thinks about you bad things. You know, you make her cry, whatever. So this can cause you a great deal of punishment. Lo aleinu. A person has to be very careful how he treats his wife, you know? Not to be too harsh with her. Not to say harsh words. Because every little thing, every little word for a woman is like a big deal, you know? It makes them cry, makes them very upset. They're very emotional. They're very, you know, very sensitive. They're not like men. We're like tanks, you understand? We're like, you know, armored tanks we are. That's what we are. You could tell me a thousand things. I'm like, nothing is going to happen to me. You know? Okay, so he told me this. He cursed me out. This, and okay, tomorrow is going to be the same thing. But women, use one extra word. She's going to remember it for 20 years. You know, what he told her 20 years ago. Remember what you told me 20 years ago? That thing that you were, I'm never going to forgive you for that. Why not? You know, can't you forgive 20 years ago what you did? So the Zohar says over time, this is before the woman gets married. What happens is that why does a woman want to get married? There's really no mitzvah for women to get married, by the way. They're not commanded to get married. The men are commanded to get married. The women are just helping you out with that. You understand? The whole mitzvah of getting married is on the man. It's not on the woman. So then why does a woman want to get married? It's their nature. You understand? To get married. Everyone wants to get, you ask a woman, right? You know, every young lady, you know? What are you looking for? Oh, I want to get married. I want to get married. No, that's all they think about day and night. You understand? So why is that? She's not commanded to get married. So what brings her into that? So they say, by the way, that the reason is because the Zohar says that the woman, because she has midah of din, she's the right judgment, she's attracted to the chesed of the husband. She wants to connect with that. She wants to hook up with that. You understand? So what happens is that since she wants to hook up, that's why she wants to get married. Because what happens is that once a person gets married, the neshama of the husband goes inside the woman. You know, it rests over there. You understand? A part of the neshama goes in there and rests inside the woman. So that gives the woman comfort. Why? Because that changes her nature from din, and it puts an element of chesed from the husband inside of her. But the Zohar says something amazing, right? Not only is she looking to hook up with a man because of the chesed of the man, right, the kindness of the man, but when she hooks up with the husband, actually does get married, so she loves chesed, the kindness, so much, she becomes much more kind than the husband itself. You understand? In other words, the love that she acquires for that, during the, you know, once they get married, that makes her love the chesed more than the man. So that's why, you know, when you go to somebody's house, usually it's the woman who does everything for you. You know, sets you up the bed, sets you up the food, sets you up the service, everything. Why is that? Because the women are the ones being, right, who are in charge of the chesed in the family. So that's why, Rabotai, that, they say, right, that person, when he gets married, he should look for, you know, several qualities in a woman, right? So one of them is the midah of chesed, right? You should be a kind person. If the girl has a good heart, she's a kind person, so she'll treat you well all your life, you know, that's the way it'll be, you know? But if she's very cruel and, you know, nasty, and every little thing, you know, becomes like, oh my God, you know, you can't live with a person like that. Everything, every little thing, you know, she can't do kind. Once she gets upset at you, she can't be good to you anymore, ever, in your life. A person like that, very dangerous, you know, to marry a girl like that. You understand? You can never have a good, because she'll make you suffer all your life. Why? Because, you know, she remembers what you did yesterday and last year and 2 years ago. She can't forget these things. She can't put them behind her. So when a woman is like that, the person is going to suffer all his life. You understand? So a person has to look for, when a guy gets married, he has to look for the midah of chesed, good-hearted person. you know, somebody with a good heart. And then you have, you can make a good family with a person like that, right? It can last also, by the way. Because what happens is that when the marriage, is, you know, is not solidly founded, it can break up very easily. Why? Because there's not a good connection there. You know, there's not a good. It's not very solid. And this is the reason why they were looking for the Midah of Chesed. We should stop here. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen. Amen. Chazak u baruch. Thank you for coming. God bless you.